Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, let's go on together, but say it. Before I give you sort of a more in-depth introduction, I'm going to do something a little bit different. I would just like you guys to participate. It's kind of like a game show at this stage. If you have heard the school that I say, raise your hand. Everyone got it? Simple enough. If you have heard the name of the school that I say, raise your hand. Are we ready?
Yes.
Okay. United States Merchant Marine Academy. Okay. The Webb Institute. Colorado School of Mines. Stevens Institute of Technology. A couple of hands for that one. Cal Maritime. A couple of hands. Babson College. Two hands. Okay. Worcester Polytechnic Institute. VP knows what's going on. Okay. Kettering University. If anyone raised their hand, I know you're lying. There's no way you know that one. The Rose Holman Institute of Technology? No one? Lehigh University? No. The Cooper Union for the Advancement of Science and Art? One or two? Clarkson University? Couple hands. Capital Technical College? Again, if you raise your hand on that one, I know you're lying. I don't even know what that one is. Washington and Lee University. Missouri University of Science and Technology. One or two hands. New Jersey Institute of Technology. One hand. Milwaukee School of Engineering. Bentley University. One or two hands. Three hands. Santa Clara University. Expecting more. That's in-state. Those are our people. That's Northern California. Okay, maybe I've heard of that one. The Illinois Institute of Technology. A couple of hands for that one. UCLA. Everyone raise their hand for that one. USC. Everyone raise their hand for that one. Okay, so does anyone have any idea what just happened there? Why I picked that list of schools? Any ideas? Ms. Kasarian mentioned return on investment schools, which means what are you putting in and what are you getting out, right? Do we care about that? We're going to make an investment in college and we expect our children are going to have jobs that pay money, they're going to be gainfully employed, they're going to be able to go and have lives. Okay. I started with the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy, which a couple of you recognized as, I've heard of that. Number three in the United States, return on investment. Number three. Webb Institute, which no one has heard of, is in New York. It's a very small school. If you want to build ships, primarily for the United States Navy, you go there and you are making six figures when you walk out the door. Colorado School of Mines, I'm a little surprised I didn't see hands for that. One of the best engineering schools on the left half of the United States in Golden, Colorado. Number seven on the return on investment list. Each one of the schools going down is just couple of pegs lower and a couple of pegs lower. And notice I finished with SC and UCLA, right? So the lowest school on my list that I published a couple months ago in College Knowledge Quarterly, which is a journal I like, was the Illinois Institute of Technology, which ranked tied for 56th. So where's SC and UCLA? Schools that I know you fawn over. My alma mater, UCLA, is tied for 93rd. And USC is tied for 153rd. So every single school that I read to you that you haven't heard of is doing a better job returning investment than the two schools you would kill to get your child. That is kind of the stunned silence I was expecting. So for some of you, you're thinking, wow, maybe I need to kind of tilt the way I look at this particular problem, because we are viewing it as a problem. For others of you, you're thinking, I'm a crazy person, and you're going to continue to pursue the same three schools. Well, I'm not here to tell you not to. What I am here to tell you is the universe of schools is much, much larger than you have ever given it credit. My responsibility as a college counselor and a college trainer is to make sure that families I encounter have a clear, more accurate understanding of the way the American college system actually works. Once we get past that, then we uncover the million-dollar question, how do we get into the, quote, best schools in the country? So yes, I'm gonna make you sit in your seats long enough for the sequence. Now, everyone came in here and hopefully grabbed one of these forms. I'm gonna ask you at the very end of the night to complete it in one of a few different ways. Do not start filling it out now. I will explain this when we wrap things up. Now, let me give you the proper introduction. So my name is Rob Schwartz. I actually wear three different hats in the college universe. The first is, I do work for Premier College Guidance. Thank you for such a great introduction. I do appreciate it. I've been an independent college counselor. Now this is my eighth year. And I do work for an organization in Westlake Village called Premier College Guidance. The second hat that I wear, again, Ms. Kasarian and I bumped into one another, so to speak, as I was her instructor recently in the UCLA College Counseling Certification Program. So I teach college counseling for UCLA. I've done so for 2 years, and I will continue with it next year. The third hat that I wear is, just like your college counselor, I'm a college counselor. I work for a private school in Simi Valley as their counselor of the day. And my primary responsibility is to empower them with a college readiness program. So I have pushed all of my proverbial chips into the middle. This is a poker reference. This is what I'm going to do until I die. My background, believe it or not, as much as I'm telling you, hey, don't get too excited about SC or UCLA, well, I went to UCLA. How did I end up at UCLA? My cousin Russ, who is, for the record, Dr. Russ, said, and I quote, "Dude, check the box." Those inspiring words, after he said them to me four times, I relented and said, okay, fine, Russ, I'm not gonna get in, there you go, I just threw $45 that I don't have in the toilet. I ended up applying to six colleges as a senior. Now, I grew up not far from here. I went to Birmingham High School, back when Birmingham was a reputable high school. And I applied to six schools. I applied to UCLA, I applied to UC Irvine, I applied to UC San Diego, I applied to San Diego State, which was my safety school. Back then, if you had a pulse, you were admitted. Now, do not make that mistake. It is one of the most difficult schools in the state of California to get into. Now, I also applied to the University of Arizona and Arizona State. So what happened? How did I end up at UCLA? Well, University of Arizona never got my application because my guidance counselor lost it. That was the problem. I have never used such bad language in front of a superior like that in my life, and then got away. Arizona State, I went, I live in the San Fernando Valley. This is back when we used to have stage one smog alerts. If you guys, parents, you remember the old stage one smog alert? When you weren't supposed to go outside and play because it was unhealthy. We had them all the time. Could I think of a place that was hotter and crappier than where I already lived? Sun Devil Stadium was maybe a clue I had applied to the wrong place. So I contacted Arizona State and I said, I'm just kidding, please withdraw my application. So I was down four. San Diego State, my safety school, checked my pulse, I had one, I was admitted. Irvine said no. UC San Diego said no. San Diego probably said no because in their application, they asked for which college was I applying. I didn't even understand that concept. What was the difference between a university and a college? This was beside me as a 17-year-old kid who was a first-generation college student. My parents, my grandparents never went to college, and I was the eldest child. I didn't know what I was doing, which is why cousin Russ said, hey, dude, check the box. That's how UCLA ended up on my list. I didn't know what school to pick at San Diego. I think I picked the engineering program at the time, and I was planning to major in political science, so they knew something was wrong. So it was UCLA or San Diego State, probably a pretty easy decision both then and now. I go to UCLA. At the time, there's 24,000 undergraduate students. There are now 31,000 undergraduate students. My very first class was History 1A, which was basically dirt to 1500. And I walked in, I walk all the way across campus, and I walked into the one lecture hall in Dixon Plaza on the far north end of campus, and there were 525 students in the room. I was used to a public high school with 3,000 students, and I'd never seen anything like this. I sat in the fourth to last row because that was the first open seat I could find, sat myself down, and from that distance, even with 20/20 vision, I had to squint to see the professor. And at that distance, strangely enough, he looked a lot like Ronald McDonald. It was just like a red fro walking back and forth talking. I was a lousy fit for UCLA. Now you might say, does that mean you were a bad academic fit? No. I was a lousy fit for UCLA because I was the type of kid when I was a sophomore, a junior, a senior in high school, I like to raise my hand. I like to ask questions of my instructors. Guess what didn't happen at UCLA for a few years? You're not asking any questions in those lectures, I assure you, because you don't want to be the person to ask the stupid question with 400 other people in the room. Even in the second and even the third year, many of my classes still had well over 100 students. So unless you were a really driven student who wanted that interaction, you weren't getting it. Now, if your child says, Mom, Dad, that story does not cause any problems for me, I would like to sit at the back of the room and be left alone and be anonymous, and I don't care if my student ID number is how people address me versus my name. Oh, by the way, 900-934-987. That's my student ID number at UCLA. I still remember it. I graduated in 1998. So these are the types of things that I want to make sure you are paying attention to. Is yeah, you know the name. And yes, you probably watched the football game on Saturday, well, unless you turned it off just after halftime. In case you didn't hear what happened, we were down 44-10 and came back and won the game against Texas A&M. But these are the things that you typically make some sort of a connection with UCLA. What I'm suggesting is you guys need to understand what it is you're buying as consumers, first and foremost. Because that's precisely what you are. You're a consumer. You're buying a consumer good, just as surely as you're buying a house or a car. There are 2,250 U.S. four-year nonprofit schools for you to choose from. How many do you need?
One.
If we do it right, you need one. So your odds of picking a school, virtually assured, if you want to go to a four-year school in this country, you can fall out of bed and get into a good college. Notice I said a good college. There are an enormous number of very good schools in this country, some of which are very hard to get into. You already know that. But what about the schools that are also highly ranked, if you believe in rankings, and we'll talk about that in a minute, that admit almost everyone? I'll give you an example. Kansas State University is a large public university. You can compare it to a school like UCLA or a Cal State school, just so you have a reference. It's about 16,000 undergraduate students. If you're into the sports, top 25 football, top 25 basketball, top 25 baseball, almost every year. Play in a major conference, great school spirit, very inexpensive, because as you can imagine, living in the middle of nowhere in Kansas is cheaper than California. You get a lot of tuition breaks being a California student. You might actually go to that school and spend less money than if you stayed here. The admission percentage at K-State is 96%. It's been as high as 99. It's ranked 150th in the country. Remember, 2,250 schools, it's top 150. That means it's a really strong school, but it admits almost everyone. How is this possible? How could this be? Real simple. It's a popularity contest. We are in the most populous state in the union with some of the most popular schools. Californians are not flocking to leave this state, but people from the other 49 states and from around the world are flocking to try to be here. Does that mean our schools are better? No. It means they're more difficult to get into because the math requires that to be a true state. That's what I want you to be thinking about. Quick question, show of hands, how many of you, parent or student, are looking into an engineering program for college? Small number. Okay. The name Rose Hulman, Institute of Technology, the one I mentioned earlier in that list, number one undergraduate program in engineering in the United States, if you believe U.S. News and World Report. For the record, I think very little of U.S. News and World Report. Why? Because I think the way their formula is designed about how they come up with their rankings is primarily hogwash. However, when we start looking at individual majors or individual graduate programs, there is a lot more value to what they're telling us. So I'm telling you a school that two people in this room had heard of is the top undergraduate engineering program in America. If you end up getting my newsletter, you'll be reading about Rose Hulman first week in October, because I'm profiling that school in my newsletter. There are so many amazing hidden gems that you're not pursuing because you're looking at the same five schools as every single other person is. Is that a fair statement? I'm not expecting you to raise your hand or acknowledge me. Just think about that. If you think about how many students in the senior class in this school are applying to the same five schools, I would wager 80% are applying to the same basis. Is that fair? That's part of our problem. Because you can go back and look at the track record, and you can say, okay, let's see, how many students apply, I don't know these numbers. How many students last year applied to USC, and how many were admitted? And then what about the year before? Now, of those 2 years, how are they doing? Did any of them drop out? Are they performing admirably? Are they well-adjusted? Does it look like they're going to graduate on time? Colleges are going to base what they do in the future based on what they've learned in the past. If your students are thriving, they're likely going to take at least as many, maybe one or two more the following year. If they're not performing very well, they might stop taking students. So that's something you need to consider. You also need to understand, what is the overall percentage of admission? When you guys are thinking UCLA, you can go and pull the data about how do California students fare at that institution. If anyone has looked, this past year, 15%. One in roughly seven very, very smart young people were admitted to UCLA. Does that mean your ratio should be one of every seven? Might not be. Depends on the strength of your school, depends on the strength of the applicants and the applications themselves. There's a lot of factors that go into these decisions. So at a school like the University of California, in terms of the things you as students control, there's really five things. The first is your curriculum. Are you taking challenging classes? Did you push and take the AP class or the honors class? Did you kind of cruise to make sure you got an A and you took a basic level course? Now this isn't to say you're supposed to take AP everything. Colleges are not looking for you to take AP lunch. There is no expectation that you're going to eat 12,000 calories in 30 minutes. Okay? Oh, you got sick before fifth period. Oh, you only get a B. That's not how this works. The idea is push yourself sufficiently hard, but pick the classes that make the most amount of sense for you. You know, there are students who will say, I'm going to take AP psychology and AP art history, and AP stats. Well, why? Well, because I hear they're easy and I want the college credit. Wrong answer. What are you planning to major in? Is there an alignment between your AP coursework and what you plan to major in? So for those of you who raised your hands earlier and said, yeah, I'm interested in engineering, are you taking AP calculus as a senior? If the answer is no, there's a problem. Because you are not demonstrating to a college that's looking at your ability to perform entry-level engineering tasks that you're capable of doing the work. So you're making it very easy for them to say, you are not qualified, we're not taking a chance on you. Now, the same student who says, I'm interested in political science, doesn't necessarily have to be in calculus to be admitted. There's no reason to, because you're not going to use calculus. So what are you going to use? Well, you might use world history, you might use European history, you might definitely use U.S. history. You don't have those items on your list, Colleges are wondering, why not? So choose your coursework carefully. It's not about taking the most rigorous course load, it's about choosing the right course load. Second item on the list, the obvious one. It's your grades, it's your GPA. How well did you perform in the classes you elected to take in high school? Here's the catch. There's about 12 ways to calculate a GPA. Some schools do 10-11 only. Some will do 10-11 partially weighted. Some fully weighted. Some unweighted. Some will take all of 9th, all of 10th, and all of 11th. Same issues. Some will take 10-11 in the first semester of 12th. Same issues. You start to go, wow, how do I calculate a GPA? How do I know exactly where I'm at? Oh, it's not crucial. If you're within 2 or 3 tenths of a GPA point of a normal admitted student, it's probably not your GPA that's not getting you over the hump in that school. So are you performing admirably? Are you challenging yourself? Those are the first two things. Number three, standardized test scores. Now, I didn't tell you that prior to working in this industry, I worked for the Princeton Review for almost a decade. So standardized tests and I, we go way back. What I will tell you is, they are important, but only to certain schools. The further you look at a list of requirements for a college, the more that particular number begins to shrink. So Cal State University has only 3 values, curriculum, grades, and test scores. So the test score for the Cal State is very important. It's about 25 to 30% of the decision. Then you go all the way to the other end of the spectrum, and you look at a small liberal arts private college where they're looking at all sorts of factors, your test score might not even be a requirement for your application to be complete. And if they are looking, it's a minor issue, or maybe it's used to justify a scholarship. But rarely does it come into play to decide, are you worthy of admission to their school? So treat the standardized test with the respect it deserves, but don't become a slave to it either, okay? Along those same lines, let's be very clear. How many of you are familiar with the SAT? Which show of hands? Almost everyone. How about the ACT? Almost everyone. Excellent. Doing a good job. So I will not waste your time describing the differences between them. Here's what you need to know. Colleges could care less which one you take. If you take them both, wonderful. They'll take the highest one by national percentile. You're never punished for trying one of these exams. What I will also tell you, prepare the first time. Don't just go take the test and go, all right, well, now I've generated a bit of a complex because I'm not very happy with my scores, and now I start to think, maybe I'm not that good at this. I'd rather you do all the preparation before you take the first test, go in, smash the thing in the face, and go, I'm pretty good at this. I think I could do better, so I'll take it again. Very different way of approaching standardized tests. 80% of the game is mental. So understand that you can help your child deal with standardized testing by doing the preparation first. Okay. Now, most of the time we think about college admission, that's typically where families draw the line and go, okay, that's how we get in. Not at the selected colleges. Let's keep going. Number four would be essays, personal statements. Every school's a little bit different on what they ask for. For the University of California, as I'm sure everyone in the room knows, you have 4 essays you now must complete as part of your application. There are 8 prompts to choose from. Doesn't matter which ones you pick, there's no loaded question in there. And you get 350 words for each of your 4 essays. That goes by like that. 350 words is an eye blink, and it's gone. So choosing your words carefully is probably the most important thing you can do in terms of acknowledging how to write the essays the right way. Almost every one of my students whom I work with, that's a major struggle. Even really good students who wish to major in English, that's a struggle because they don't exactly understand how to write an essay assignment that they've never been taught to write in this particular way before. Okay? You're telling a personal narrative. The word I frequently shows up. Think about what happens when you use the word I in your 10th or 11th grade English class. Mom and dad are getting a call. What's going on here? You're probably getting a D or an F on assignment because we're not interested in your opinion in that way. But when it's autobiographical, like your essays or your personal statements are, you are the only reason they're reading. They don't want to hear about your parents or your grandparents or your neighbors. They want to understand the context of you within their school. What do you bring to the table? What makes you interesting or different compared to your peers? That's what's trying to differentiate you beyond your numbers. If it was just numbers, this is a real easy game. I assure you, it is. Number five on the list, extracurricular activities. And I'm being very broad when I say extracurricular activities. This is anything you do outside of the traditional classroom, okay? Clubs and organizations on or off campus, sports on or off campus, volunteering on or off campus, church work on or off campus, travel, hobbies. You like astronomy. You've got a great telescope that, you know, once a week you haul into the backyard and you take pictures of the heavens. That is an extracurricular activity. Just because you don't get a certificate or you're part of an organization doesn't mean it doesn't matter. Okay? I have two extremely simple rules as it pertains to extracurricular. Rule number one, students, do what you love. If you're doing something because you think colleges are going to like it, you're doing it for all the wrong reasons. Do it because you love it. Do it because you're going to be able to understand yourself or the world around you a little bit better. Colleges will appreciate that. Second, if you happen to know what you wish to major in, you engineers, I'm going to pick on you again, are you doing anything to allow you to better understand your interest within the context of that major? Meaning, you want to study engineering, but other than you took calculus, you have no evidence in your record, in or out of class, that you have any idea what you're talking about. How am I, reading at a selective college, supposed to trust you? That's really what this comes down to, right? I have to trust that you have some idea of what you're doing, or you're not going to change your major four times. Let's take another one, which is real easy. Anyone here hoping to become a doctor? Parents hoping their child will become a doctor? This is a real simple one. Talking to an 11th grader, and they say, oh, Rob, for sure, I'm going to be a doctor, probably a surgeon. First thing I say, ever put your hand inside a dead body? I know, weird comment. And y'all get that same look that I just gave you. Well, here's the thing. There's a program I do recommend. It's a competitive program. Not everyone gets in. It's a gross anatomy program in Augustana College in Rock Island, Illinois. Feel free to jot that down. It's a summer program. It's very short, 3 or 4 days. But your child is going to cut open a cadaver, deceased body. And they're going to learn the anatomical structures. They're going to look at veins and nerves and arteries and muscle tissue. And they're either going to be over here going, this is the coolest thing in the entire world. Bring me another dead body. Or they're going to be over here, passed out. I would want to know that if I'm a parent funding an education with a goal of med school. That is an expensive lesson. I would much rather your child learn that in between 11th and 12th grade for a few $100s, then the third year of their pre-med program when you've already sunk 60 or 70 grand into this pursuit. Take the time to understand what really fires you up as a student. And if you do that, it's going to allow you to paint a very clear picture to the colleges you're interested in to explain why they should in fact trust you. That you've done the heavy lifting. You've done the hard work to say, look, this is what I want to study. This is why I want to study it. And even more interesting, because I've done my research, this is why I'm coming to you for it. If you can make that kind of a compelling statement in your application, colleges are far more willing to take a chance on a student that maybe the grades aren't quite as good, standardized test scores a few points below what we're looking for. But gosh, you're compelling, and you've done the hard work, and I think we can trust that you're going to get through our program. I've seen it too many times. That is basically the end of the line for the University of California. Now, what about all those small and medium-sized private schools? Number six, letters of recommendation. We're a small school. How many students are in the senior class? 42. It's a microcosm school. It's teeny tiny. If you're not building relationships with your faculty and your counselor, you're doing something wrong. Because when you ask for those letters of recommendation, you're not asking for a letter of recommendation, you're asking for a great letter of recommendation. Because what's the point of anything less than that? Think of the students at Granada Hills Charter High School. You guys know Granada? Does anyone know how many students are at Granada? 4,500. It's the largest charter school in the United States. Just ask them, they'll tell you. They have three college counselors for 4,500 total students. Good luck building a great relationship with your counselor. You don't have that problem. Well, you don't necessarily have a choice. Sometimes you have to. The common application requires certain letters of recommendation. So while you guys are in 10th and 11th grade, you ought to be building rapport with your teachers, with your counselor. Because ultimately, your counselor's job is not to just simply, you know, regurgitate some brag sheet that you gave them. It's that she understands who you are, what you do, why you do it, why you are an interesting person compared to the other students at the school, and your fit within where you are applying. If she can make that connection for a college, your odds of admission just went up. But that requires a relationship. That requires a conversation. But that is not your counselor's responsibility. That is your responsibility. Seek her out. Ask her advice. Number 7, maybe the most mysterious of all on the list. Demonstrated interest. Has anyone heard of this term before? Demonstrated interest? Our vice principal knows what's going on. For everyone else, pay attention. For the public schools, they could care less. You made an official visit. Yay. You gave us a call. You sent us an email. You filled out a little postcard. Yay. They don't care. They'll track it for informational purposes, but understand that a school like UCLA with 102,000 freshman applicants last year, probably going to be 105 or 106 this year, they have no time for you in that regard. Now let's say you're applying to a school with 5,000 undergraduate students, and their incoming freshman class has 1,200 or 1,300 students, tops. I assure you, they have a file with your name on it, pre-application file, and you came to a college fair, and they scanned you in. You have now a file with your name on it. You followed up with a question after they messaged you and said, hey, thanks for coming by our paper. They recorded that email or that phone call. Maybe you decided to make an official visit to that campus. You didn't just walk around. No, no, you took the time to go to their website and book a tour. They noted that. You followed up with an additional question. They noted that. Why are they doing this? They're trying to predict your child's behavior. They're trying to understand if they admit your child, what is the likelihood they're going to say yes back? Does this seem crazy? Does it seem like profiling? Maybe a little bit, but understand why colleges do what they do. 2,250 of them, one of you. And their job in the Office of Admission is not just to get the brightest students, it's to get the ones that fulfill the mission of the college or university. And that means the best musicians and the best athletes and the best political science students and the best engineers and the best pre-med kids and the best everything they're looking for. So we're crystal clear. If you're looking at those smaller or medium-sized private schools, you can literally adjust a yes or no decision based on how well you demonstrate your interest in the school. Okay? Show them the love they're looking for, and you might get a reward you're not expecting. Now, are we all familiar with the term early action and early decision? Show of hands, how many of us are familiar with those? Just a few. This is a really important topic as well. So, if we talk about the Cal State, when we talk about the UC system, it's real easy. We have one and only one deadline. It is November 30th, of the senior year. As long as your app is in by November 30th, we're good. Don't try to turn it in the day after. We're not interested in talking to you anymore. However, for every one of the schools that has one deadline, there are many, many more that have multiple deadlines. So for instance, there's a school that has an early decision one deadline, an early action deadline, an early decision two deadline, and a regular decision deadline. What does that mean, and what do I do about it? Let's start with the easy one, regular decision. This is the end of the line in terms of a deadline. It's going to be the last one. You have made no commitment to this school other than you've given them an application. They're going to read and review you just like everyone else in line. Okay? You have no obligation to this school. Early action. Early, just as it sounds, you're applying earlier than the regular deadline. There is no binding agreement here either. You applied early, you say, hey, I really like you, I'm applying early, I got all my stuff done, tell me early. That's all they're doing. So if you apply, let's say, November 1st, by Christmas, they will either give you a Christmas gift or they will crap on your Christmas. It depends on where you apply. So early action, great. So you applied November 1st to a school that said yes to you on December 20th. Oh, this is so great. You have till May 1st to tell them yes or no. Now, don't think they will not try to urge you to make a decision. Oh, you should get in touch with us right away so you can get the housing deposit in, so you can get the first choice housing. They will tell you, they will sell you the song. They're doing it for a reason. Now, the critical one, the one that we need to pay the most attention to, is early decision. This is a binding contract, just like you're sitting down with an attorney. It is signed by three people. One is the student, two is the parent, three is the counselor. It is an acknowledgement that says, we are certain, we are accepting your offer of admission before we even apply. Here's my application. You get one and only one, okay? So let's say you apply early decision to Vanderbilt University. You were admitted to Vanderbilt University. You go, this is great. I got into Vandy. This is like the Ivy of the South. This is great. And then a week later, they send you the student aid report, which is the financial aid offer. And you go, oh my God, they didn't give me anything. They want $63,000. This happens, by the way. Are you still obligated to attend that school? The answer is maybe. If you can prove that an error has been made, an egregious one on their part, that, hey, look, I went to your net price calculator on your website and I gave them every accurate piece of information I had, and it says it was going to be $29,000. And now, all of a sudden, now that I don't have an option for any other school in America, now I'm going to pay full price. That's not right and it's not fair. I'm breaking the agreement because you didn't hold up your end of the bargain, Mr. and Mrs. College. Other than that excuse, you're going to court. That is not an exaggeration. You are going to court if you're trying to break that agreement. Not only are you likely punishing yourself, but I guarantee you will punish the next generation of kids at this school who try to apply early decision to Vanderbilt. The answer will be no, I assure you. They will punish this school. So understand that early decision, you get one and only one. It will, in almost every case, increase your chances of admission. Why? Because the colleges have a guaranteed student. They get 100% of the early decision pool, but they might only get a small percentage of their regular decision pool, which makes it very difficult for them to figure out how many beds and how many seats do we need to fill. If we fill too many, where are we going to put everyone? And if we don't fill enough, well, then we have a money shortage. We have a very interesting universe we live in where we don't pay attention to just how bad the other side's job actually is. When you look at a cranky, unhappy, constipated looking group of people, just go to an office of admission of your favorite school in April. It's a rough place. Every single day they're checking, wait, how many did we get today? Oh, we got 22 today. Oh my gosh, we had 27 last year. What are we gonna do? For an entire month this goes on. It is a very difficult job to do. And so that's why they are so interested in using things like early decision to try to level the playing field. So they will take a larger percentage of the students. Here's the deal. If you know you are going to rely on need-based financial aid, you cannot, in good conscience, use early decision. Because what if you can't afford the offer they give? Early decision is for the following people. Number one, you know the school you want to attend. It is by far your first choice. It's not 99%, it's 100%. Number two, if you were admitted to that school, you don't care what the price is, you'll pay it. If you meet both of those qualifications, I urge you to take advantage of early decision. Now, I'm gonna give you a little trick of the trade. For those of you who are thinking, gee, Rob, this is really great, we appreciate the insight, how do we get into the Ivies? And of course, you then ignored everything I said about there's great schools all over the country, blah, blah, blah. You apply early decision to Cornell. Why? Well, you said you wanted to go to an Ivy, right? Cornell is an Ivy. Cornell has over 16,000 undergraduate students, which means they need a lot of bodies. They take an enormously large percentage of their early decision population. There you go, free charge. Aren't you glad you came? So, quick recap. Curriculum, grades, test scores, essays, extracurricular activities, letters of recommendation, demonstrated interest. Are there other values that colleges can look at? Yes, but it depends on the school. Sometimes schools will look at your ability to pay. Believe it or not everyone is, oh yeah, I mean, you know, you have two pennies to rub together? Sure, come on in. Many schools are what we call need dependent. They do not just have oodles and oodles of money coming out of their pockets. That number is, guess what, shrinking every year. The schools that don't care, those are the wealthiest schools in the country. Those are the Harvards and the Yales and the Princetons and the Stanfords, and they could pay for every single kid in their class 10 times over. That's a very, very small amount of the U.S. college population. For the majority of American schools, they will look at your ability to pay as a small part of the admission decision. What about your ethnicity, your race, your religion? If we're talking about a public university in this state, the answer is legally no, they cannot. In 47 other states, they can. And in 100% of private schools, they are allowed to. So I would suggest finding schools where you are not ethnically represented, because that can only help your cause. Do you have a legacy, or did your parent or grandparent or sibling go to that school? Your odds of admission at most of those schools will tick up a little bit. Is it a slam dunk like it used to be at USC? Absolutely not. The more difficult it is to get in, the less value you will find in things like legacy. But all of these values can come into play. So the best advice I can give you is to do the following. Number one, be unique. Find a way to be different from everyone else who you work with and you play with in this school. What are you doing that no one else is? Number two, understand that your success in this college search process is based on, are you doing the heavy lifting? Are you taking the time to really go out and figure out what it is you want and where you want it and why you want it and who has what you're looking for? For my students, I do an extensive search, hand by hand, one by one, to find the right list. And then, most importantly, is to teach students how to do the research. Research does not mean open up U.S. News and World Report and go, oh, that one's 27, that one's 53, that one's not on the list, so this one must be bad. Wrong approach. Are you identifying the things you as a student really care about? Are you as a parent identifying the things you really care about? For instance, everyone, again, so high and so loving about USC and this community. Has everyone here taken a tour of USC? Has anyone taken a tour? few of them. So you take the tour, it's a beautiful campus, and they treat you like $1 million, and it's a great experience, right? No one ever walks away from a tour at USC and goes, wow, that sucked. No one ever does, because they're really smart people, and they take very good care of you. Why? Because you're a customer. You ever stick around until 9 or 10 o'clock at night on a Tuesday and walk across the street to get something to eat? Well, of course you don't. Well, why? Because it's downtown LA and you fear for your life? That's where you want to drop your kid off. That's what you're saying. You have a son, maybe you slide on that. You have a daughter? Now, I'm biased. I went to UCLA. I teach for UCLA. So if you think I'm biased, that's fine. But I can tell you, if I had a daughter, it's not on the list. I don't care how great the school is, wrong place. I'm not going to be able to sleep at night for 4 years because I know she lives there. You as parents need to think in broader terms. Where can I go and study what I want to study in an environment where I'm comfortable, in a place that I can afford, where I will have the opportunities for personal, social, and professional growth? If you can handle the weather, and you can handle being around a lot of light. So here's the thing. Have a broader interpretation of a good college. Of the 2,250 schools I told you about earlier, if you said, how many of the schools in the U.S. admitted more than 50%? 50% of the students who applied last year, the number is almost 1,900. Of the 2,250, higher than 50%. Of that entire population, 2,250 schools, the highly selective population we came here to discuss tonight is 60 schools. That's it, 60. And yeah, Harvard and Yale and Princeton and Stanford and Caltech and MIT, all the goodies, they're all in there. But so is the Curtis Institute of Music. So is, in my neck of the woods in Valencia, CalArts. Anyone heard of CalArts? A lot of you heard of CalArts. If you're familiar with Pixar, that's where Pixar was born. 25% admission rate. You're thinking, wow, great school. They only admit one out of every four. But if you're not planning on being a digital artist or a film studies major, then what are you doing there? You don't fit what they're doing. The most difficult college in America last year to get into was Alice Lloyd College in Kentucky. Would have lost a lot of money if you played that game with me. 4.9% admissions, an all-girls school in Kentucky. Just because it's hard to get in doesn't mean you should be looking. Have a realistic understanding of how this universe actually works, and you will find you are far more empowered than you let yourself be. This stage of the game, when you have a short list of 10 schools and all admit 5 to 25% of the students, you have forfeited your power and you've given it to colleges. And for 5 or 6 months, you will sweat it out and hope someone says yes to your child. This is a dumb approach. I don't have to sugarcoat it. It's a dumb approach. Find the schools where you believe, and your child believe, they're going to be able to study what they want to study in an environment they want to study it, regardless of the percentage of admission. If you do that, I promise you there is a reward that comes with it. First, they're not freaking out, which means you as parents aren't freaking out in October and November and December and January and February and March and April. 7 months of pure torture is an option. It's a choice. Let me give you an example of one of my students. A gentleman lives in Northern California. I work with students literally all over the state. And 4.27 and a 32 ACT. This is a very bright young man, okay? He only applied to 3 schools. Against my better judgment, I said, really, 3? This seems an inordinately low number. Why are we doing this? He says, okay, well, here's my rationale. I'm going to apply to UCLA. I said, okay, you got about a 50-50 shot. But if you get in, you're not getting any money. Okay. I'm going to apply to UC Irvine. Okay, you got about an 80% chance of getting in, but you're going to get no money. Okay. I'm going to apply to the University of Nevada at Reno. I said, they're going to admit you the first second your application apply, or your first second the application arrives. And then within 2 weeks, you're going to be awarded the top scholarship they can give you, which is the Presidential Scholarship. It's exactly what happened. So he's admitted to Irvine, he's admitted to UCLA, he's admitted to Nevada Reno. The choice is simple. Am I going to go to UCLA and pay full price, which is $36,000 and change? Am I going to go to Nevada Reno, study in newer facilities closer to my home, and pay $16,000? Well, wait, but it's out-of-state tuition, right? Not at Nevada Reno, is it? Nevada Reno is a Western undergraduate exchange school. They have a guaranteed admit for a 3.0, and he's above a 4.0. So they start to drool and froth at the face when they get a student like that from California, and they'll back the truck up to help that kid come to their school. And what did my student say? Very bright young man at 17 and a half years of age. He said, I can go to UCLA and that'll be great and be a lot of fun and I'll enjoy it. And then when I go to graduate school, I will have to borrow for every dollar because I will have exhausted all the money my parents have given me for college. Or I can go to Nevada Reno, have a great experience, still be close to home, still have the Division I football, baseball, all that good stuff. Be a big fish in a little pond, as opposed to UCLA where he's going to be pedestrian. And all the money my family is saving will allow me to not have to borrow a dollar for graduate school. Guess who's starting in Nevada Reno? This is what I want you to be thinking about. Leave options available. If you do that, you're going to find this is an easy process. And that fear and that pressure that you feel now belongs to the colleges. It's their problem to compete for you. But it's a choice. Just acknowledge it now. It's a choice. And if you do that, you will win the college game. And if you don't, well, we'll hope the percentages fall in your favor.
In that scenario, is there any consideration to, when he does apply to graduate school, to say that he graduated from Nevada Reno versus UCLA?
Great gold star question. Thank you for asking that. So another great myth of this system is I have to go to an Ivy League school to get into an Ivy League graduate school. Wrong. 3 years ago, just 3 years ago, two undergraduate students at Cal State Northridge, which I have a master's degree from Cal State Northridge, it is not a mecca for higher education. I have no problem putting down my own alma mater in that regard. Two students, undergrad, Northridge, Harvard Medical, same year. There's only 165 seats in the entire program, in the world. Two students from Northridge. Does that mean Northridge somehow got better? Or those two students were amazing? You will make you successful. If you leave here tonight and you understand that, you're winning. You will make you successful. Let's take another example. The third richest man on earth is Warren Buffett. Who has heard the name Warren Buffett? Excellent. You guys watch economic news from time to time? He's on it constantly. He's the president and CEO of Berkshire Hathaway. He got his bachelor's degree from the University of Nebraska, Lincoln. Go Cornhuskers. They admit about 70 to 75% of the students who apply each and every year. He got his MBA from Columbia, which is an Ivy League school. So you can start almost anywhere and end almost anywhere. That is the truth. Now, if I have a 3.9 at Yale, and she's got a 3.9 in Nevada Reno, and we have basically the same standardized test scores, and we're applying to the same MBA program, yes, the kid from Yale is going to win. Sure. But understand that there are unique opportunities that will open themselves up to students who are at the top of the food chain at their schools versus the middle of the pack. The same thing happens in graduate school, interestingly enough. Data has been pulled that shows if you're in the top 1 or top 5% in your graduate program, your PhD program, we judge success for these programs based on how often and where you publish. Okay? You're in a PhD program, how are you doing? Are you publishing? How many times and where is your material showing up? The study showed that it wasn't the rank of the college, it was where you were in the pool at that college that determined how successful you were. So you're in the top 1% at Harvard, you were the top of the food chain. But the top 1% at St. Mary's College of California is doing better than the 35th percentile at Harvard. Because they're getting the unique opportunities for their school that is not unique to Harvard at the third or the quarter mark. So are you at the top of the food chain where you attend graduate school is honestly more important than the name on the outside as well. That's what the data tells us. I'm not making that up, and I'm not trying to deflect you away from where my clients are all applying. I tell them the same thing I'm telling you. Have an open mind.